So at this time, we just want to call our first participant this morning, our first speaker. She's going to give you a dynamic testimony. This is no other than Sister Irene Thompson. Irene Thompson Tidwell. How's that? All right, and after Sister Irene, we're going to go further. We got some outstanding men and women of God that will be ministering after Sister Irene comes with her special testimonial.
Well, I just wanted to, first I'd like to give honor to God. And I thank the Lord for the opportunity to be here. Because truly it is a blessing to be here. You know, everybody is not as fortunate to find the right church. I do know that when you let God lead you and direct you, you'll never fail. You'll never make a mistake. And when I have moved in the area, which has been, what, 23 years ago, I really prayed about it because I felt it was time for God to send me to my church home. And this is where He brought me, and this is where I'll be. Well, last Sunday, when Brother Dean asked everybody to come down. Well, I had already been, let me back up. When I first came to church Sunday, I was in so much pain. My back, when I woke up that morning, it was hurting so bad. And I just kind of pushed forward. And in fact, I talked to my husband and I told him, I said, it was hurting. So I said, but I'm just going to go on. And Puckett called me. Kalila called me. And either I call him, wake up, make sure she get up, she'll call, say, you going to church? So she called me. So I knew she wanted to go too. And so I pushed forward. And when I got here that morning, my back was hurting so bad. And I was trying to stand, and literally I just started crying to the Lord. And then after a while, I was crying in pain. I mean, it was just my whole back was just hurting so bad. And to the point I was up, almost begging God. God, you got to heal. I need a right now miracle. Heal my back right now. I don't know what it is, but God, I'm in so much pain. And so anyway, Brother Dean, when he had asked us to come, everybody to come up to for healing or whatever, or to pray for whatever they need, to get on their knees. And I was standing there and I said, man, I need to do that. So then, but I was just standing there. And so finally, he said, God just said, you said you wanted to be healed, so you need to get on up there. And so, and I always say I'm a special child, he repeats things to me twice. So he said it again, you said you wanted to be healed, so you need to get on up there. So I went up there. And I think I was the last one to get up. And I do have I don't have a bad knee, but my knee hurts sometimes. I hurt it when I was working in corrections. And my knee didn't even hurt. The whole time I was on my knees praying, it didn't hurt at all. And I didn't realize until I got back to my seat, my back wasn't hurt. And I was like, okay, Lord. Praise God, thank you. But as we sit there, he asked for people to come up. And I got to thinking, well, I don't need to come up. I done got my healer. I'm good. And Puckett said, you going to go up there with me? And so I said, yeah. So I kind of teased her. I said, in fact, I'll hold your hand. Come on. So we went on up. And as he was praying for the other people, before he got to us, I just felt led to just pray in the spirit. And I was thinking on things that I wanted for her. And I just started thinking on those things and praying in the spirit. And I mean, as I prayed, I began to cry, because I want so much for her. You know, we've all been through something, but I know she has some pains in her life right now that still bother her. And sometimes you really don't have a background where you know about salvation and all that. So I know she's blessed because she's accepted that in her life. She accepts what Pastor Hill is teaching us. But I know some things that she's still going through, and I just continue to pray and think on those things so God can heal her of those things and to give her peace and to help her to flourish and grow in what He would have in her life. And I just continue to pray for her. And then I thought about my daughter, Keisha. She hasn't attended in a long time. And again, I want y'all to continue to pray for her that she will be saved. And God will plant her wherever church she needs to be. If it's here, if it's not, that's fine. I just want her to be in God's will for her life. So I prayed for her. Then I thought about all the other kids. And I said, you know, they all mad. You know, they're with their mom now, but they're all mad. So I prayed for some things, special things that I know is going on in their lives. And then I prayed for myself. And there's some things I know I need to do concerning my health. And I made up my mind, Lord, again, I'm not going to go back. I'm going to be obedient. So tomorrow, I'm going to start. I'm going to start walking again tomorrow. And it was just things I was thinking and praying in the spirit. And when Brother Dean got the pumpkin, it's like everything I prayed about, everything came out of his mouth. And then when he mentioned about writing and putting it down in a journal, I thought for a second, I said, what? She don't do that. She writes it. And so I said, okay, Lord, I received that too for her. And then when he got to me, it was like everything I prayed concerning myself, he spoke it. And I was just so delighted because it was just like instant confirmation, everything he said. And I just got so excited. And Monday I started, and I started walking, and as I was leaving my driveway, I thought about my neighbor. And I noticed that she don't really go out a lot anymore. And I know, you know, she's had some real challenges. In fact, the devil has attacked her so many times concerning her health. And even when she was, when I first moved there, had the house built and everything and moved, she, one of the patients she was taking her, like, attacked her. And she got hurt. I mean, it seemed like everything just kept happening to her. And I said, that's the devil. He's a lie. I said, he is out to destroy you. But no weapon formed against your pride. We just started praying. I mean, God just started helping me to encourage her. And so I thought about her. And I called her on the cell phone and asked if she wanted to walk with me. And I didn't even know it. She said, when she came out, again, God will use you. If you just go on and do what you think he's telling you to do, do it. She said, I've been wanting to walk so much, but I didn't want to go by myself. And she's walked with me every morning since. Amen. And I told her, I'm committed to Monday to Friday. I'm not saying Saturday or Sunday. Maybe sometimes on Saturday, but Monday and Friday, it's a done deal. And I know some of you are believing God for me with, about my health. Yes. And somebody prophesied on what size I'm going to be, and I'm receiving that. But you know, God is good. But I can't do my part. I don't want to continue to be stagnant because, like I said, it's been a long time since I lost them, what, 4 or 5 dress sizes? I'm kind of standing still, but that's how the enemy will get you. Because standing still means you're going backwards, because it doesn't help your health. You need to continue to work and do for. Y'all just encourage me, but God is awesome, and he will perform. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. All right. Isn't that good?
Yeah.
All right. Praise him. God is doing some wonderful things. Amen. Also, we just want to bring Sister Jessica or Mariko, they are partners together in prosperity. They have learned and mastered how to manage their finances. And now she's shared with several of our members, and they've gone through these courses. They were going through also the marriage classes. And they have just really gotten things together, amen, and going in the right direction. We just thank God for what God is doing through them. And we just want to let God say whatever he wants to say. Y'all just do it any way you feel led to do it.
Good morning.
Good
morning.
Good
morning.
Pastor Hill asked me to kind of talk about financial peace. The class that I'm facilitating, I wouldn't call myself a teacher, facilitator. On Sunday evenings, and we're almost finished. We have 3 more weeks left, including this Sunday. I'm on the financial peace class. And if you haven't taken the class, I would strongly encourage you to come and also bring somebody. If you've ever had an issue of how is this money going to get here, or if you say you were driving to church today and you ran over something and all 4 of your tires blew out and you had to replace them, would you have the money right now to just go replace the tires? And those are things we learn in financial peace. Sorry, that's my child screaming. But those are things we learn in financial peace about the just the common sense things that we need to know. The word is good, and to come and pray is wonderful, but when we get up off our knees, we have to do something. And my sister Irene said, you know, the Lord is a healer, but she has to do her part to keep our health intact. But, you know, so we learn how to actually handle the money that God has given us. And one thing that we know, statistics tells us that 7 out of 10 Americans live paycheck to paycheck. That means that in any neighborhood that you go through, no matter how big the houses are, how run down the houses are, you can count out 7 of those houses in every 10, and they're trying to figure out how they're gonna make it. And we also learned in financial peace that once we're free from the burden of debt, the debt that's hanging over us, we're free to serve God so much better. In our class, we had 13 families, and our debt total, not including our mortgages, is $557,000. What could we build with $557,000? You know, and that's not even the entire church. If we took everybody's debt total, what would it be? How many millions? But, you know, those are things that we learn. That money, if we learn to manage the money that God has given us, He'll continue to give us more. And we could build so much with just what we already have and what He's already given us. So, if you haven't taken the class, like I said, I would strongly encourage the next go around. It's a 13-week session. It's an $85 commitment. That's your books, your materials, your CDs. Also a lifetime membership to Financial Peace. So, and then also, just one thing I heard this morning, I was listening to Meet the Press or something, and I heard the president, he was speaking to the Congressional Black Caucus, which would be black folks, and he said, it's time to take off your house slippers and put on your work boots. He said, it's time to get up. There's work to be done, and we need to do it. And that the economy is not going to recover with us just sitting down doing nothing. It takes individuals. We can't wait for some economic bill or law to be passed. It's not going to, it's always going to be up to you where you take it. So that's all I have.
Amen. I'm up here, you know, supporting Jessica. She speaks with so much patience and poise. Anyway, I will add to this, you know, a couple of weeks ago, you know, my grandfather had passed away, and he always taught me to invest in yourself. You know, I remember when I was 17, 18, 19 years old, and working for him, we had to buy our own equipment. And I'm thinking to myself, man, he used to encourage us strongly to purchase our own lawnmowers and, you know, leaders and stuff like that. And I was thinking to myself, you know, back then I was wanting to buy me some Guess jeans and, you know, latest fashion. You know, I was trying to, you know, keep up with everybody. But he would make me take my money and buy equipment. And that's investing in yourself. So now I will fast forward the clock. I'm like, I'm so glad he did that, because now it's nothing for me to see something that I want as far as business to allow me to make more money. I drop in a minute because I'm seeing how much it will cost me. I'm seeing the big picture. I'm seeing, okay, if I spend $1,000 over here, that $1,000 is going to bring me, what, $4,000, $5,000? So I put that $1,000 back and work off that $5,000 on this profit. So now I turn around and do it again. And then put that money back, turn around, and that's how you build wealth. You know, and he used to always encourage us to do that. So I am totally very appreciative of him doing that. And sometimes we try to figure out where's this money gonna come from. And you know, some people get back $4,000, $5,000, $6,000 back at the end of the year. And you know, taxes, a lot of times we don't know it's right there in front of us. You can take that money, and if you're entrepreneurial or you don't have a business mind, you can take that money and start. You know, a lot of people don't look at it like that. I mean, when me and Jessica first got married, I used to always figure out ways, you know, to make money. Start off with a vending machine business, start off with, I've always bought me, you know, lines, you know, equipment. I would use that money to, you know, help us out. And some of that money was, you know, used to, you know, for the, you know, janitorial to a certain degree, you know. But I used to just, you know, invest in myself, and that's the key. You got to invest in yourself. You can't be scared, you know. And once we realize that, we can create our own jobs. You know, we can create our own jobs. Just do it. You know, I'm just going to say, you know, I really truly believe that my family, we're going to be all right from here on out.
Amen.
I'm scared to not have no money. I grew up like that, you know, coming up, you know, it was tough, you know, going to bed eating carrots or, you know, crackers, and you know, that's tough. And I just can't see my son or my daughter, or me and Jester, doing that again, because I lived it, I've been there, you know. Going to school, going through the lunch line twice, man, that's embarrassing. So I was have done that before too, got called out, but I survived that. But the key thing is to invest in yourself. I'm serious about that. Whatever money you get, try to use that to, you know, do nails, do hair. Say, you know, hey, I'm gonna put an extra amount of, you know, money towards that and watch that grow. You know, and turn around and do it again, keep doing it. Next thing you know, you look back at 15 grand set aside somewhere, you know, tithe off that one. I'm pretty sure that's, you know, more of that come. So that's all I have to say.
Have you ever done this at the expense of your giving to God?
No, not at all. He asked us building our business and putting back money, have we done that at an expense to giving to God? I mean, absolutely not. When we got married, that was one of the things we were committed. We're going to be tithers. And like Brother Wayne said, this word is going to be true. You know, and it says that if you give, you know, he would open up the windows of heaven. And I heard someone say, open up the windows of opportunity. But you got to be in a position where you can take the opportunity. And no, we haven't done it at an expense to give it to God. As a matter of fact, for the first, five years of our marriage, we didn't have cable. We had one cell phone. Our apartment was probably about the size of this podium to be a prison. By choice, yeah, that was my choice. We could have, you know, consumed everything we had, but the Bible says that a foolish man devours everything
that's
he
right.
has.
That's right.
And in the house of the wise, there's choice food and stores of oil. In other words, there's an emergency fund, there's stuff like that. But no, we never did an expense. We always thought about what we were going to do first. Bible also says that the diligent shall prosper. In order to be diligent, you have to be doing something. So I think that's pretty much it. But yeah, financial peace, you learn all this, so come out.
A lot of things that Dave Ramsey is speaking about, I heard my grandfather say that 20 years ago. I'm serious, that's everything. When I first heard it the other day, Dave Ramsey through this church, and some of the stuff he was speaking about, I was like, man, my grandfather said that, you know? He always taught me, let me get this right. If you own a business and if you subcontract and everything, I'm speaking on a subcontracting point of view. If you take 20% and live off that 20%, or like say for instance, if your business is doing, let's say $100,000 a month and you live off $20,000 a month. You invested 20,000, you're getting 20,000 in return of 20%. In other words, the banks can't even give you 20% on if you put money in the bank. I mean, they give you what, 1.7%? So he I did the math. I'm like, wait a minute, okay. That's all I need is 20%? He said, you go anywhere. If you put $1 million in the bank at 1.7%, you still won't get back $20,000 a month. I mean, that's just one example. So in other words, I hope I'm getting this right. I hope everybody understands what I'm saying. So in other words, the bank is giving you 1.7%, but if you have your own business or profit something at 20%, I mean, that's a no-brainer. So.
I'm going to ask Walt, who never lost for words. He's doing the same thing that Brother Mariko started out doing, and he's going to tell you how he's doing it and how God is leading and blessing him. And very nice brother, Campbell. And I know he's going to succeed. Even he's really moving forward fast.
Lord, we have this say I'm thankful for my church family here. Pretty much my brother-in-law, my mother, father here. If anybody don't know them, you should get to know him. I'm following Brother Mariko's footsteps. something I never did before. I had a few jobs here and there. Been a cook, been a machine operator, construction worker, behind the desk, all that. Pretty much everything. I'm 26 or 27 next month. So the big picture for me was my kids. You know, that's the bottom line. Once I had my son, things started changing for me. I grew up in Oak Cliff in Dallas. Didn't really have much. Going to sleep, eating the crackers, bologna sandwiches every day, pinto beans, tuna fish, chicken, you know, the right to what you don't eat for a couple months. But you do with it, you know what I'm saying? So yeah, I had to feel that because you ain't had to do it before. Like you said, you don't want to go back to that no more after you don't been there. Yeah. I heard today, the kids got harder than what we used to have. Seems like every year, every generation gets worse, and it's all due, it's our fault, parents' fault. Everybody point a finger everywhere else, it's our fault. If we don't want to teach them at home, they don't want to go out, go to school, they don't want to go to work. They don't know, you know, before they leave the house, they ain't gonna know in school. But in order for them to learn, you have to teach them how to learn. You can't just scream at them every day, you can't yell at them, you can't force them to do things that they don't want to do. And that's what's going on out there. You know what I'm saying? You don't do that because that's what your daddy did. You don't do that because this is the way it's always been done. Well, time has changed, so change has to come. One day or another. But, in my life, like I said, my brother's been a blessing to me. When I got here, I ain't have to die. $300 a month. So I came up here. $300 a month on faith. Before I left, I had just got a job. Didn't understand that. Leaving, just got a job. Why we leaving for? It's all I've been asking for. It's a job, but for some work, we can come up. I didn't understand that. And I don't leave my family, so I don't understand. Came up here on faith, you out, kids, my baby. We didn't have no car. Yeah, no car, it's just us, my pregnant wife, and U-Haul. So, any of y'all ever did that, all the way from there, it's in U-Haul, which kids. Imagine how that feels. And all your stuff for your house. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, it's a blind trip. All I had, like I said, was my family word. This is my family, because they don't have their word true from day one. You know what I'm saying? I got a family at home, can't depend on working it. So, you know what I'm saying? Anybody that I depend on my family. Amen. So, long story short, y'all, it's been a year and a half. I probably done purchased 2 cars by now. Not living month to month, just as far as the bills and everything. You know what I'm saying? Used to come buy groceries. You know what I'm saying? See stuff on TV that I want that. Couldn't get it for them. You know what I'm saying? Now, y'all drive by the house, 2 cars out there. You know, with the help of my family, be able to provide everything that my kids ever want. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? That feel good to me because I'm actually moving in a direction. There's no way you can tell me I'm doing wrong right now. You know what I'm saying? You can tell me wrong, you're going in the wrong direction. And I had people tell me that. So, you know what I'm saying? People don't believe that what I'm doing is worth the time I'm putting in and stuff like that. In the long run, you know what I'm saying? Anything you do in life, it don't come by you doing it overnight, 24 hours. It ain't gonna happen. The free cell phones, they passed now last week. No people will fly to go get the cell phone, but you gonna give your social security to somebody you don't know? I mean, that's stuff I think about. I don't know what everybody else thinks about. But that's your life. Because when you go to work, or you go to get a job, or anywhere else, they want your social security number. Yeah. They want your name and birthday. So you're going to get this to some strangers. This is what I'm talking about. We got to teach our kids. You know what I'm saying? So we the first ones running to the line to get the phone, which they the kids don't do. So, I mean, stuff like that. We got to be aware of what's really going on. The truth. That's all I really seek is the truth. You either real or you ain't. You know, tell somebody that's what I do and and say they see doing something else, which what they gonna be able to do. Well, he bent the rules a little bit, so maybe, you know, I can bend the rules, you know.